Hello, everybody, and thank you for joining me today. It's Alan Barry Labacan with the Rocks and Stocks News Show. We've got another of our In the News segments, and I'm going to get right on to it with a share screen here. The big news, I think, today is that the Federal Reserve has decided to stop raising interest rates. They did say that recent indicators suggest economic activity has continued to expand at a modest pace. Then they say job gains have been robust in recent months and the unemployment rate has remained low. Inflation remains elevated. So I don't know how those, there's a lot of things I think that are pretty contrary in that opening statement, but that's the Federal Reserve for you. They say that the US banking system is sound and resilient. I find this somewhat laughable. We're just in March, we had a banking crisis. And what caused that banking crisis was caused by the Federal Reserve after the 2008 economic crisis. They, for 14 years, they had near zero interest rates. Then they jacked them up dramatically. A lot of the central or a lot of the small bankers, as well as larger bankers, including the Federal Reserve, are loaded up on long-term bonds and bank commercial backed or real estate backed debt. And those are underwater and toxic. And that's what's caused the banking crisis. And I think it's a long way from over because a lot of institutions, small banks, big banks, the Federal Reserve, other institutions own the same kind of debt. Assets, and I don't think that's going to get better anytime soon. Tighter credit conditions for households and businesses are likely to weigh on the economic activity, hiring, inflation. Yeah, no kidding. The households are using their credit cards to make ends meet, and they're paying 20% interest on that, and the use of that is quite dramatic. So I think that's a bit of an understatement. The committee remains highly attentive to inflation risks. Well, if you cause the inflation risks and you don't recognize you caused it, I don't know how attentive that is. They say that they seek to achieve maximum employment and inflation at the rate of 2% over the long run. Well, we'll see how they magically do that. In support of these goals, committee decided to maintain the target range for the Federal Reserve rate at 5 to 5.25%. That's all I'm going to talk about from that that communique that I think is more about public relations than it is about economic reality. The reality is that the Fed caused a lot of problems with that long-term period of near zero interest rates. They haven't recognized that. Now they're breaking things. They're breaking the housing market. They're breaking the consumers. They're breaking the small banks that still hold a lot of those toxic assets. And there's in a very short period of time, the commercial real estate is about to have a reckoning. So I really think that the Federal Reserve is done now in raising interest rates. They say that they're not, but we'll see. They also say that they're not going to be lowering interest rates. Now, this is a hard one for me to believe. You know, over time, it only is a few short months after they stop raising interest rates that they start lowering interest rates. Now, most times they've only raised interest rates a little bit. This time they moved them up aggressively. And so they want us to believe that this time is different, even though the moves have been quite dramatic from near zero to 5 to 5.25%. Percent. And I think that the problems they've caused are going to ripple and create a lot more problems. And then you've also got to throw on there that there's a global currency war going on where the BRIC nations want to hold less U.S. dollars and U.S. Debt, and they want to have a competing currency for reserve currency as well as for international trade. These same countries are backing, are buying gold like it's going out of style, and have been doing that since 2008, with 2022 being their record after that, in that period, and 2023 is set to be even more. So I think the main strategy for investors that want to protect their money should be holding gold and silver and other assets like that. And really, I think that those that want to grow their money will be best off in the mining stocks. They're trading at very low valuations, and yet demand is very strong, and supply is very weak. So these things all conspire to move the price of gold and silver, copper, and other assets much higher. And so I think we're at an inflection point for the mining stocks. Something that I've been talking about lately is that I'm seeing the volume drying up on the mining stocks. And that's an indication to me that those that have wanted to sell their stocks at low valuations, the classic sell low, and then they'll buy back later at higher prices, is now finished running its course, and the next big move will be a breakout to the upside. Okay, let's go into some news releases. One of them is Galantis Gold. Earlier today, they announced Galantis provides progress update on the Omaha Gold Project. They said that QME Mining Services of Ireland has successfully concluded its due diligence process at the company's Omaha Gold Project in Northern Ireland as part of its work on a sustainable mine plan. It is envisioned that the mine plan targeted for completion in July 2023 will allow the company to further develop and mine the ore zones down to the existing lower levels of the Omaha mine. The mine plan is aimed to optimize production from the dilation zones, which have potential for higher grades and thicker widths of mineralization. The mine plan will outline a staged production plan, estimating the initial production levels, followed by staged expansions of production. The company believes that this will be a lower capital cost pathway of de-risking the growth in production, while the company continues to focus on exploration and expanding its minerals resources at Omaha. The forthcoming mine plan will involve mining both the Joshua and Kearney veins, leveraging QME's highly skilled workforce and state-of-the-art original equipment manufacturer mining equipment. Mario Stefano, who's the CEO of Galantis, commented, "We are thrilled that QME is progressing our mine plan. QME's extensive mining experience across Europe, including its notable involvement in the development and bulk sampling of Dalradian's nearby gold project located just 20 kilometers away from Omaha, positions them as an ideal partner for the endeavor. Furthermore, QME's commitment to the success of the Omaha project is exemplified by its significant shareholding, over 3 million shares in Galantis. We look forward to providing further information on our mine strategy next month," end quote. Actually, I'm going to be interviewing Mario tomorrow, and I'm really excited to talk to him about a couple of things. One is that they talk about the mine plan and the importance of the dilation zones. These are zones where the rock opens up, dilates, and you can get more of the metals bearing fluids in there. Another thing that it's very important for is their exploration drilling, because they got a distinct trend to those dilation zones that I think is going to give them help as they follow this system deeper. Another thing that I want to talk to Mario about is they shared some pictures of the drill core from their VMS project in Scotland, And I saw some really nice looking sulfides in there that suggests to me that they're hitting what they're expecting to hit. And we're going to talk about those two things tomorrow. So stay tuned for that. Another sponsor is Goliath Resources. A couple of days ago, they announced that they're doing 18,000 meters of drilling at their Goliath's extensive new high-grade gold-silver discovery in the Golden Triangle. It's more than just that to me. I think that this is one of the most important new gold and silver discoveries in the prolific Golden Triangle. And I think that they're going to do a lot, have a future mine here. The 2023 drill program is 70 holes from 21 separate drill pad locations with four diamond drill rigs, and they're planning 18,000 meters. And included is a maiden drill program, their newly discovered gold swarm zone. The drilling season will focus on new discoveries and further upside potential. They want to expand the footprint and higher grade mineralizations of the Sherbet zone and the Bonanza Shear. They show expand the footprint of the Sherbet to the northeast and southeast. Maiden drill program at Gold Swarm. They can here they show you some of the outcrop at the Gold Swarm. So they want to get under that and see what's under there, but they definitely have some exciting grades in that outcropping material. They want to test the Sherbet's extensive porphyry feeder source confirmed by the Colorado School of Mines within the newly identified high-grade Golden Gate feeder zone, where angular float samples assayed up to 924 grams of gold, 3,000 grams of silver, some copper, 12.6% zinc, or lead, and 4.11% zinc. That's some very nice looking rock there. Yeah, they've got a great program lined up. They've got lots of targets to drill on. And I think that they've got something quite spectacular here at this Sherbet zone. They have more zones that are stacked on top of this. They've got a couple of important structures here as well as over here. And they all seem to be coming together down at the bottom of the mountain, the mineralized zones, the structural story. And now they're going to target the feeder source of that, potential feeder source of that. So I really like what I see out of Goliath. As I said at the start, I think that they've got one of the most important new discoveries in the Golden Triangle. And they're cranking up the drills to move ahead. Okay, Focus Mining, they had a news release out. Jean Rainville, who is the president and CEO of Focus, stated, and I quote, "Drilling in 2022 and early 2023 on the RB zone indicates significant near-surface gold. We plan to fully evaluate this new gold zone with the potential of objective of being able to add to the NI 43-101 compliant inferred resource estimate delivered last March. The RB zone and the corridor that joins the Herd zone offer substantial near surface gold potential, and testing these areas remains our priority in 2023. We will also be reassessing the open pit potential of the GP zone, where only underground potential was examined in our recent resource estimate. This will not be an expensive exercise, as no additional drilling is required and metallurgical testing was already carried out on this last year," end quote. So I'm going to go to their corporate presentation now. Just give me a second here. And there it is. And I'm going to scroll down here. What really stands out to me is this long section here. As you can see, the GP area is where they have the most drilling, and it's all right at surface. They've also got very nice hits over here at the top of the Hendrick zone. Minimal drilling, but nice hits in this RB zone, and minimal drilling, but nice hits on this Herd zone. So it looks like they've got the makings of a pit shell here That could be quite extensive. I believe that these are 500 meters square. So you're talking about a couple kilometers of mineralization, and then you look at the geophysics, it's got lots of legs to it. And so I think that this company has the potential of finding a multi-million ounce open pit target on the Cadillac Larder Lake Break, which is an important region in Canada. Lots of big mines have been found on that trend, including the Canadian Malartic, which I followed very closely from early in their days of success at the Osisko. These guys are in Quebec, near a town, near roads, near power. So I like their open pit target potential, as well as following the system deeper. So I'm actually going to be putting out an interview with Jean Rainville here in the next couple of days. So stay tuned for that. We talked about all of this. Fireweed Metals they put out really good news release that they announced their minerals resource for the Mactun project, which is the largest high-grade tungsten deposit in the world. Mactun is the world's largest high-grade deposit of this critical mineral tungsten. They talk about the resources, the grade. In addition, an exploration targeted is estimated at 2.5 million to 3.5 million in a similar grade area. The resource estimate includes estimates for the critical mineral copper, in addition to gold, and metallurgical test work is underway to determine recoveries of these byproduct metals. Mactun is contiguous with Fireweed's McMillan Pass Zinc Lead Silver Project, accessible by the North Canal Road, and provides potential for future project synergies. There's a map down here somewhere. Let me get to it, where they show you just how close this is to, there it is. There's Mactun. There is the McMillan Pass project. I really like this McMillan Pass project because they're moving closer to the source of the mineralization in their Jason Tom end zone. And it looks like they have a potential feeder. They're drilling away right now. Stay tuned for a lot more news to come out of this company. Next up is Heliostar. Heliostar drills 46 meters grading 13.4 grams per ton of gold within 129 meters grading 6 grams per ton gold at Ana Paula in Mexico. This is a new acquisition for the company, it's an advanced project that was advanced based on the concept of an open pit. But now they're focusing in instead on the high grade portions of that, with the idea that it could be a substantial underground operation. When you start hitting 129 meters of 6 grams, that's some pretty sweet stuff. They also hit 46 meters of 13.4 grams of gold, 28.5 meters of 17.4 grams of gold, 13.95 meters of 6.4 grams of gold. Really looking like, and here you can start to see the shape of this high grade portion of the system. So what they're effectively doing is they're proving up their concept that they don't want to go after this with an open pit. They'd rather go after it underground, and the grades and thicknesses that they're hitting certainly suggest that is a future. Look at these thick intersections of high grade. Let me see if there's a quote from Charles Funk there. Charles Funk, who's the CEO of Heliostar, stated, and I quote, "The key to our vision for Ana Paula's future is to define high-grade underground mineable gold mineralization. The current drill program's exceptional intercepts reinforce this view. The results from hole AP23-293 illustrate the potential with 139% increase in grade relative to the current resource model at a 5 gram per ton cutoff grade. This hole fills a gap in the historic model. It connects a continuous 195 meter long strike length of drill hits with more than half an ounce of gold per ton. The crew on site has moved this to drill test the up plunge target next. This target has the potential to extend the strike length of the high grade panel, end quote. So there you go. If you like gold and you like underground mine potential in Mexico, Heliostar fits the bill, and I invite you to do some homework on that company. Okay, the next company is Canadian Gold Corp. And, you know, this is an interesting news release that I didn't get a chance to talk about earlier last week, but I wanted to. In it, they say that Rob McEwen clarifies ownership in Canadian Gold Corp after financial website provides conflicting information. Rob McEwen wishes to clarify that he has neither sold nor transferred any of his 60 million shares, representing 37.6% of Canadian Gold Corp. A certain financial website showed conflicting information that made it appear shares were sold. This may have led to the decline in Canadian Gold Corp share price yesterday. Canadian Gold is working with the website to correct this information. So, you know, when this happened, the stock was trading at around 30 cents. Now it's trading closer to 20 cents. And although they made this clarifying news release, sometimes when you get a downtrend, even if it's on erroneous information, there can be pressure. And but what I why I really like this story is because of their tartan mine that they're now going drilling for the depth potential of that what looks like an orogenic gold system to me. And what's really exciting is that underneath the underground workings and below the historical resource estimate, there was a couple holes put deeper, and they hit these thick intersections of high grade. And these things don't happen by accident. I think that there's a big, powerful gold mineralizing system under there, and they're drilling that depth potential to prove that. I think they will. I don't think you get 20 meters of high grade by accident. I think there's a lot more high grade down there, and they're drilling to figure that out. And keep an eye on Canadian Gold Corp. Exploits. Exploits Discovery Corp announces new gold discovery at their bullseye with high-grade results averaging 38.2 grams per ton of gold over 2.8 meters. So this is in Newfoundland. It's in the Appleton Fault Zone. They found lots of visible gold in their drill core. As you can see, they hit some bonanza grades in there and lots of gold in the system. They call it their horseshoe gold zone, and it remains open in all directions. Diamond drilling totaling 11,300 meters has been safely and cost-effectively completed over the 30-hole first phase evaluation at Bullseye. Assay results from 18 of the 30 drill holes have been received and publicly reported to date. The results from the 12 remaining drill holes are pending. Jeff Swinoga is the president and CEO, and he commented, and I quote, "We are thrilled to announce our first gold discovery called Horseshoe on our Bullseye property. Our first phase of drilling so far has intercepted visible gold in a half dozen drill holes and generated several high-grade intercepts up to 118.92 grams per ton gold. Consistent with this high-grade intercepts that our peers are reporting just south of Bullseye, our geologists are seeing mineralization within a complex network of multi-stage quartz veins. I'm very proud of our local team's accomplishments during this first phase of our drilling campaign, end quote. So they talk about some really important stuff there that I want to unpack a little bit. One is that they're seeing visible gold. They're also seeing a complex network of veining. This is the kind of thing you want to find in an orogenic gold system. Another thing that they mention is that they're on the Appleton Fault, and down here is where Newfound Gold has been finding all of their big zones of gold. So you're in close proximity to that. And now these guys are finding a lot of high grade right in here. With lots of visible gold. So, and look at this Newfound Gold. They have this Everest discovery here, 36.7 grams per ton gold over 3.78 meters, 28 grams over 2.3 meters. Just on the other side of the Appleton or the claim block and to the east of the Appleton Fault, where the east side is where Exploits is getting their zones. But the other side of the fault is also quite important because, as you can see here, Newfound Gold is also getting zones on the other side of the west side of the Appleton Fault. So it definitely looks like Exploits has a critically important or crucially important land package here on the Appleton Fault. And most importantly, they're getting some joy with high grades and visible gold in their drill core. So I think you've got a lot more to look forward to with Exploits, and I'll work on getting them on an interview to talk with them a little more fully about these results. Alrighty, so there you go. That's the In the News show for today. Do your homework, speak with your financial advisors, and have a great day, and we'll talk to you soon.